Hi, my name is Gabe. I'm a mathematician and a tutor, and I'm excited to introduce you all to hypothesis tests today. Today's topic will introduce us to hypothesis testing, one of the most important concepts in statistics. We will begin by briefly discussing the goal of hypothesis testing, which will help us interpret the results of these tests. We will then outline the general structure of hypothesis testing before we finally explore the statistical interpretation of these tests. Let's get started by understanding why we perform hypothesis tests. The goal of a hypothesis test is to establish statistical significance. Now, what does this mean? Let's consider an example. An old way of setting speed limits on a road is called the 85% rule. You go to a road and you monitor car speeds for a few days, measure maybe 1,000 cars, and whatever the 85th percentile of their speeds is, you set that as the speed limit. This is because you generally want most people going below the speed limit, but it is expected that people will, in some situations, go a little faster. Suppose you do this and find that this number is around 40 miles per hour on a particular road. It might be important, however, to go check on that speed limit again in a few years to make sure that the 85% rule still holds as traffic changes. If you only measure, say, the first three cars that come by and you find that they are going over 40 miles per hour, should you change the speed limit? Does this reflect a change in the behavior of all cars, or just that you, by random chance, found three cars that were going very fast, and over a long period of time, you will still see that the speed limit should be 40? With this sort of question, we can employ a hypothesis test to determine whether an observation is due to random chance, or it can be used to make a strong statistical conclusion about the reality of a situation. A hypothesis test starts from the fundamental premise that any observation might be due to random chance, and that the statistician must prove that the observation is meaningful. A hypothesis test consists, in general, of five stages. In the first stage, we construct the null and alternative hypotheses. In our speed limit example, our research question is whether 85% of the drivers still obey the speed limit. Our null hypothesis in writing would be that yes, 85% of drivers go under the speed limit. Mathematically, we would write the null hypothesis as H(0, P), which stands for the proportion of drivers who go to the speed limit, equal to 0.85. Meanwhile, our alternative hypothesis, in the case of whether or not this is the right speed limit, is that some proportion of drivers other than 85% of them obey the speed limit. Notice how this does not say anything about whether we need to increase or decrease the speed limit, nor by how much the drivers are disobeying it. It just provides the alternative answer to the research question of whether 85% of drivers are obeying the limit. Mathematically, we write this as H(A, P) not equal to 0.85. Because we have a not equals here, this is referred to as a two-tail test. We just want to know that the null is wrong in any direction, not necessarily that the true proportion is greater than or less than the null. In general, if the direction of an alternative hypothesis is not equal to, then we are performing a two-tailed test. If the direction of an alternative hypothesis is greater than or less than, then we are performing a one-tailed test. We are performing a two-tailed test in our speed limit example, but if we were to change the alternative to P less than 0.85 or P greater than 0.85, that would be a one-tailed test. In step two of a hypothesis test, we calculate a test statistic. The test statistic is a way to take the data and compare it to some underlying distribution, which can tell us whether or not the observation is likely or unlikely. The general form of the test statistic is that it is equal to the sample statistic minus the value of the null hypothesis for the population parameter divided by a standard error term, which is dependent on the sample size and some function of the theoretical distribution of the population data. Depending on the population data and the type of population parameter we are calculating, the test statistic will either be a z-score related to the standard normal distribution or a t-score related to the student's t-distribution. In the third stage of the test, we use the calculated test statistic to calculate the so-called p-value for the observation. The p-value represents the proportion of times when the observation's deviation from the null value could happen by chance. Each test statistic can calculate its corresponding p-value from the appropriate distribution. For example, the speed limit problem is a proportion problem, and such things are going to be related to a standard normal distribution leading to a z-score. The z-score can be understood as living on the x-axis of a standard normal distribution, and given a z-score of 2, for example, for a two-tailed test, the p-value is equal to 1 minus the area under the curve between negative 2 and 2. This shaded area is equal to 0.954, and thus our p-value is equal to 1 minus 0.954, or 0.046. This represents the fact that an event with a two-tailed z-score of 2 has about a 4.6% chance of occurring randomly. For a one-tailed test, in particular, a right-tailed test up to the value of z equals 2, we would have that the p-value is equal to 1 minus the area from negative infinity to 2. This has an area of 0.977, which leads to a p-value for the right-tailed test of 0.023. This process of determining p-values can, in general, either be done tabularly or computationally and is specific to each problem type. In step 4, the calculated p-value is compared with the threshold of statistical significance. This threshold is generally given at the beginning of the question. For example, in our speed limit problem, we should include the statement that we hope to evaluate the hypothesis test at a 5% significance level. Mathematically, we have that alpha is equal to 0.05. This alpha is then compared to our p-value. If we take the p-value from our example, where we had a two-tailed z-score of 2 and a p-value of 0.046, and perform a significance test with an alpha of 0.05, we need to ask the question, is the proportion of times this observation happens by chance smaller than our significance level? Mathematically, we are asking whether the p-value is less than alpha. This brings us to our last step where, during the comparison, we either accept or reject the null hypothesis. When we ask the question of whether the p-value is less than alpha, we can either get a yes or a no answer. If the answer is yes, the p-value is less than the significance level, then we reject the null hypothesis and we say that we would not observe such an event by random chance. But if our calculated p-value is larger than our significance level, then we say our observation might just be a fluke and we have to accept the null hypothesis. Given our example numbers here, we would be able to say that 0.046 is less than 0.05, so the statement is true, and we can reject the null. If this had happened in the context of our car problem, we would be able to make the conclusion that we can reject the null, and that we can say that some proportion of drivers not equal to 85% currently obey the speed limit at a 5% significance level. While this video did not focus on the exact calculation methods necessary at each stage of the process, we can walk away with a solid understanding of their intent. Hypothesis tests directly answer yes or no questions regarding gathered data and a theoretical expectation at a specific threshold of significance. They cannot necessarily give you an exact value for any population parameter, but can only suggest whether or not the proposed null hypothesis is true, or whether the gathered data disproves it beyond the possibility of a statistical chance. Throughout this lesson, we have discussed the goals of a hypothesis test regarding its ability to determine whether or not we are dealing with a chance event or a significant statistical observation. We then discussed the process and structure of the hypothesis test in general. We mentioned the 5 stages of the test, from posing a research question all the way to accepting or rejecting the null. Finally, throughout this lesson, we set up an example hypothesis test, including the statement of the research question, the null and alternative hypotheses, and discussed the role of the p-value and the significance level in making a conclusion from a hypothesis test. We talked about how to interpret the results and what they allow us to say about the question at hand. Thank you all for paying attention to this more theoretical discussion of hypothesis tests. For more specific practice on particular sample statistics, Chegg has a series of videos available for you to dive deeper into this topic.